Hello everyone and welcome to Shelby This Week on today's newscast. Hydraulic fracking, the thin blue line, and Twitter. All this, plus much more, but first. Hydraulic fracking, drilling. Critics have their thoughts on fracking. Sarah Shunk reports on this topic.
Fracking, drilling, mineral rights. They're in the news, and whether you are for it or against it, wells and pumps are beginning to dot our landscape. Recently, a permit was given for a pump in Shelby Township, which has received some local attention. The decision to grant permits for oil and gas exploration and drilling come from state and not our local government.
And at some point, the state legislature thought it was more important that people be allowed to explore for oil and gas without any local control, because you can imagine if every unit of government had a different level of control, it would be hard for this, you know, those resources to be explored for and then maybe taken out of the ground.
The resources being taken out of the ground are things we use every day. And lease deals for landowners' mineral rights and permits to drill new oil wells are on the rise in Metro Detroit. More locally, the drilling is happening in the Briarwood condominium complex at 25 Mile and DeQuinder. According to state law, a company cannot just come in and drill, they need permission.
A person can't drill a well through an area where they don't have permission or have the mineral rights to drill from one spot to another.
In this case, the mineral rights owner is Nino Holmes. Usually, when mineral rights lease is signed, the mineral rights owner gets a percentage of the profits.
There typically is a what they call a bonus that a person would say they're offering on the mineral rights to lease them. They would pay a person, $20 an acre, for each acre, $20. And there's usually a term for that, 5 years or 3 years or whatever is agreeable between the two parties. If they were to then discover oil and gas under this person's property, then they would be paid royalties, which could be on anything from an eighth to a quarter or so. That would then be payable to the mineral owner.
Oil and gas exploration and drilling is a growing business. As more and more natural resources are being used, the companies are simply filling a need. For more information about laws and how to get involved, log on to michigan.gov/DEQ. For Shelby This Week, I'm Sarah Shunk.
More facts about the law. A public act states extraction of natural resources allowed unless serious consequences would result. Also, the law also allows exploration, drilling, and prohibits the township from regulating blasting hours, noise levels, and dust control measures. A company wants to spruce up a local area in Shelby. Cutter Shelby Properties went to the planning board for a rezoning request with a proposal to develop family residential homes called Wilshire Park. Location would be on 23 Mile Road, west of Mound Road. The land is vacant and has always been vacant. All that's there are some tall weeds and two drains. The company has been working on this plan for more than a year. They've owned the property for many. The plan is smaller houses on smaller lots with an entrance to be directly across from Sharon Street. The planning board decided they will work with the applicant but take the plans through another process. Planning denied the request, but will look at other ways to create the new life on this land. A local benefit shootout was held recently. Katie Shimatero reports on the skeet, trap, wobble traps, and five stands, all to benefit a good cause.
Guns, ammunition, and charity. The annual Cops and Clays charity shoot held by the North Macomb Sportsmen's Club went off with a bang. Police officers and civilians from across the state came out to support the event and benefit the Thin Blue Line of Michigan, a nonprofit organization that provides medical, legal, and financial aid to members of law enforcement and has been the beneficiary of this event for the past several years.
It's been very successful every year. I believe Scott Simpson from Shelby Township Police Department could probably give you more on numbers and how much it's raised, but it helps tremendously.
It was an emotional year after losing two very important members. Stephen Thorpe, the chairman of the event, passed away back in April. Following his death, Lori Reinecker, founder of the Thin Blue Line of Michigan, passed away after battling cancer just 1 week prior to the event.
It's been tough on us. Everybody here at the club was affected by both of those people. So this year's, it's kind of hard.
Scott Simpson, a Shelby Township police officer, is proudly following in Stephen Thorpe's footprints, running the event and raising a generous amount of money for a great cause.
The first year we ran it, we were able to write a check to the Thin Blue Line of Michigan for right around $10,000. Last year, we raised right around $13,000 for a one-day event. And according to the Thin Blue Line of Michigan, this event is their largest single fundraiser for the year.
And this year, they raised nearly $14,000. Now it's time to see if I have what it takes to shoot a gun and join the cause. After a brief lesson and some minor hurdles, I was finally ready to pull the trigger, and I understand the passion behind the event. The event allows you to have a great time while giving back to those who put themselves on the line to protect us every day. To find out more about the Cops and Clays charity shoot or to get involved next year, visit northmacombmi.org. Reporting for Shelby This Week, I'm Katie Shimatero.
Looks like that was a great day at the gun range. And speaking of police, the Shelby Township Police Department is moving up in the technology world. The police department now tweets. If you're a Twitter fan, you can follow Shelby Police Department at ShelbyTWP911. Their Twitter account will help stay in contact with the public, alerting residents of any emergencies, road closures, and more. Coming up, art fair, flea market, and the Cassie Hines in Her Shoes campaign. Stay tuned.
You promised me the world. Is this what you had in mind?
Every choice we make has a consequence. Help EarthShare and its members restore balance to the world. Visit EarthShare.org and see what you can do. EarthShare, one environment, one simple way to care for it.
A popular fair is going on in the township. Stacy Sansaterra tells us what it is.
The municipal grounds are quiet now, but the excitement will rev up August 9th and 10th for the 2014 Art Fair.
Hours are 10 to 5 on Saturday, 10 to 4 on Sunday. We've got about 78 artists this year and 29, I think it is, of Michigan-made product people. Lots of fun things going on.
I'm drawing with colored pencil, and I start out with the light colors first, and then I begin to add darker and darker colors.
And this fun-filled weekend is truly an event for the entire family.
In addition to all the great art projects and art for people to buy, there's also entertainment. We've got musical entertainment at the band shell all weekend. There's a kids craft and activity area. We've got the people from the Detroit Fly House Circus are coming back out, and they're going to be entertaining each day.
And something new this year is a street artist will be leaving his mark in Shelby Township.
We have David Zinn. He's a pretty well-known chalk artist that's going to be out on the grounds creating his own type of art and also doing workshops with the kids.
With something new each year, this annual event is always a highlight of summer in Shelby Township.
Well, I think a lot of it is the atmosphere. It's a nice, friendly atmosphere. Everybody's got something to do. You don't have to spend a lot of money to have a good time. And we try and have a little bit of something for everybody.
For Shelby This Week, I'm Stacy Sansaterra.
The Art Fair, a popular local event. Another successful event at Riverbends Park recently. There was a flea market on the grounds at 22 and Ryan. Residents stopped by to check out old and new goods, such as DVDs, clothing, kitchenware, and more.
We're basically having a sale of all the stuff we need to get rid of.
Okay.
and declutterizing, basically.
Vendors and patrons enjoyed the successful flea market. Each trinket sold has an old story. Selling at a flea market is a lot of hard work and takes a lot of patience, but the Riverbends Park was full of promising booths. A local group is following a strong woman in her shoes. Shelby TV's Alyssa Yakey reports.
The Cassie Hines Foundation is continually active in their goal to grow as an organization. They want to be able to support every cancer warrior during their battle. One way they plan on achieving this goal is through a camp, which is something that allowed Cassie Hines to renew her spirit.
She would get down in the dumps. It was her friends that she met at camp that was the people she went to, because all of us knew her. We helped her. We tried to understand what she was going through. Nobody really knew. It wasn't until she met people like herself at camp that she was able to, you know, bounce back and get that fight back in her again.
There are not a lot of outlets for young adults diagnosed with cancer, and the Cassie Hines Foundation is hoping to fill that need.
Our goal is to build a camp here in Michigan, building on sample camp as we get return campers to come in and new campers to come in. Our goal is to slowly build up into an overnight camp, into a weekend camp, and ultimately buying land and building our own cancer camp for young adults between 16 and 30.
To help support the Cassie Hines Foundation, you can get involved and check out their events page at CassieHinesShoesCancer.org. For Shelby This Week, I'm Alyssa Yakey.
That was Shelby TV's Alyssa Yakey reporting. A local conference helped teach senior citizens safety from fraud, scams, and other crimes recently. The 14th annual Safe, Sound, and Secure Conference was held at the Macomb Intermediate Building, where over 300 senior citizens attended to learn how to be on guard against identity theft, scams, and other tips on how to stay safe. One local resident attended the conference because she unfortunately was the victim of a break-in at her own home.
Well, I would like to learn more about how to protect myself. I've had a break-in at the house when I was home, and it was really scary. So I just want to watch for scams, and I've also had my credit card stolen, you know, a different time. So, they called me on the phone in the middle of the night and said, "Are you charging $9,000 on the internet?" And I said, "No, I'm in bed." But so they get a hold of your number. I don't know how they do that.
The free conference featured remarks from County Executive Mark Hackle, Sheriff Anthony Wickersham, and Prosecutor Eric Smith. Seniors could also speak with representatives from the Michigan Offices of Services to the Aging, emergency response teams, and more. These tips the seniors received could help save their lives. A local commissioner made a big impact on the community, Bobby Hill. His name and legend will never be forgotten, especially after his name is honored in the community.
There was no question when naming the lobby at the downtown Mount Clemens Welcoming Center, located at the administration building lobby. Someone who was an icon, a representative for the community, and served on the Board of Commissioners. Someone who has been an ambassador for diversity.
One of the only African Americans to actually make the on the Board of Commissioners. He'd been here for years representing the city of Mount Clemens, and always had a great working relationship with not only the commissioners, but other public officials and the community as well. So this is so fitting. And when you talk about a welcoming center, try to celebrate our diversity and our cultural differences. Bobby Hill would be extremely proud of the fact and humbled by this, that this was named after him. Had he have known this was going to take place, he probably would have said, "No, please don't do that, name it in honor of somebody else." But probably knowing now that we've done this and his family's receptive to it, there couldn't be a more fitting person, I believe, here in Macomb County from its history or currently that really deserve this recognition.
Installed in the lobby, Bobby Hill's plaque, unveiled to the community, and most importantly, his family.
2, 3.
I think the Welcoming Center represents my father's views on life and people. I think he'd be a little taken back by the fact that he's being recognized, because he was really more low-key about that type of thing. But I think the Welcoming Center and One Macomb represents, you know, his views on inclusion and diversity and how people should interact and live together as one.
The proposed new lobby will have a friendly atmosphere with seating available for all.
You know, there's going to be upgrades. There are going to be upgrades with the carpeting. Obviously, the name isn't the only thing. It's just a plaque that's going to be on here so that we do name it appropriately. But there's also going to be more of a kind of inviting atmosphere with the actual chairs, the couches, the seating area. We're going to have kind of a little cafeteria-style area here where people can buy food and engage the television monitors that will be up here for TV viewing. So it's going to be welcoming for people just by its visual presence, but it's also going to have information. It's going to have information here displayed so that people can find out where to go. If they're looking for some help or support with learning more about cultures in Macomb County or trying to seek some support or help because they really don't know how to gather that support. So it'll be here, you know, more in a pamphlet form, but more importantly, how to really get a hold of a human being to make those contacts here in the county.
His legacy and his reputation still continue to have an imprint on Macomb County's landscape. A local company is doing all it can to give back. One grape at a time. Veronica Meadows is on scene.
Wine lovers in Shelby Township don't have to travel all the way up north to get their favorite bottle. Michigan by the Bottle has you covered. The local hotspot began as a website.
It started from just a blog that just had a few readers too. We have thousands of Facebook and Twitter followers now.
At the time, co-owners Courtney and Shannon had other jobs and shared their wine experiences on the side. They didn't know that soon they would have a new career.
Anytime we went anywhere, we'd be doing videos and people would come up to us and say, I want your job. And we'd have to tell them, this isn't our real job. This is our, you know, our fake jobs, our fun jobs. And we started thinking, the more we heard that and the more we fell in love with the Michigan wine industry, we started thinking, how can we make this our real job?
They found their answer when they decided to open their own business. The idea took off.
Because when people go to the wineries, a lot of times they're on vacation, but when they come home, most of them are actually living down here in Metro Detroit. So where do they go in the interim when they can't make it up north or out to the southwest part of the state to go to the wineries?
Now they go to Michigan by the Bottle. The business represents all four of the major Michigan wine trails and has a large variety of wines for everyone's taste. Wine lovers don't just stop in to pick up their favorite bottle.
We're kind of an interesting hybrid of different uses. We're a wine store. We sell by the bottle for take home. So during the day, a lot of people are just kind of popping in and buying a bottle. We also offer tastings and flights, so series of wines.
Besides standard tasting, visitors also sign up for different events. Yoga lovers can go to Yoga and Wine. And if you want to expand your knowledge, check out wine education classes. For more information, stop into Michigan by the Bottle, located on 21 and Hayes. Courtney and Shannon show that doing what you love can pay off.
I just love it. I kind of call it my life 2.0. I had a great job before, but I feel like this is really where I'm meant to be.
So come check out Michigan by the Bottle. For Shelby This Week, I'm Veronica Meadows.
That's a great place to go wine tasting. Joseph Wasik, Shelby Township resident, passed away Sunday, July 27th at the age of 72. Wasik was a former resident of Warren in Detroit and the co-owner of Wasik Funeral Homes with locations in Shelby and Warren. He was recently honored after serving as a funeral director for 50 years. He will be missed. Millions of people suffer from back pain every year. Statistics show that back pain is the second most common reason for medical visits. John Martin reports on this next story.
If you suffer from back pain, spine surgeon Michael Kopsovkavasis wants you to know that with the latest surgical techniques and proper exercise, you may be able to walk away from back pain.
Now, is most back pain caused by similar problems all related to the spinal column?
It's a form of arthritis. Except in the cases of trauma, in general, I'm an orthopedic surgeon treating arthritis. It is a very specialized form of arthritis, and the joints of the spine are very different than, let's just say, a knee joint or a shoulder joint. But it's a cartilage problem to begin with. A herniated disc is a piece of cartilage broken off. It's just in a very, very, very uncomfortable area.
Most of my surgery is elective. The patients tell me when it's time to have surgery. There's some cases, in the case of spinal cord pressure, where we rush things a little bit just so they don't get too bad and they don't worsen. In general, we take the time to make sure that everybody is medically fit for surgery. If they are not, then they've got too high of a chance of having a complication. Even though these surgeries are very different than they were 20 years ago, as far as the amount of harm and the length of recovery, especially using new minimally invasive techniques, it still is important that everybody is medically fit for surgery. So nobody It's a rare case that somebody truly gets rushed to the operating room. Most of the older techniques involve near complete stripping of muscle off of a majority of the spine. It is very, very painful. There is a lot of blood loss associated with it. And it, let's just say the muscles never truly recover once you do that. And so it leaves people with a degree of chronic pain. Just the act of doing the surgery to relieve the pain creates a degree of chronic pain. So a lot of the newer techniques are, instead of muscle removing, they are muscle splitting. You create a hole through the muscle. You may dilate a hole through the muscle. And through this smaller portal, so to say, maybe you use a specialized retractor to do this, or maybe you use a tube. You perform a lot of the same work, however, it's done with a whole lot less trauma. The newer techniques, they can go home the next day. They have significantly less pain. There is virtually no blood loss. Does it hurt? Yes. Do they have to follow the same precautions after surgery? Most of the time, yes. But the amount of pain and the amount of blood loss is significantly less.
Now, is there anything people can do to prevent back problems?
Absolutely. Okay. Take care of yourself. Do what your mama says. generally good health. Avoiding smoking is actually very critical. People don't recognize the damage that smoking can do. Discs of the spine are very sensitive to how much oxygen is being passed to them. And when you smoke, especially consistently, you damage that blood supply. You hasten the death of those discs. So if you've got arthritis in your family and you decide to smoke, great odds you're going to end up with a spine surgeon in your life.
What about keeping active? What about sitting a lot? What should people do to try to avoid back problems?
Sitting a lot does put a lot of pressure on your discs. Reminding me to sit up straight, thank you very much. But in reality, it's just keeping active, keeping your core strong, good posture. It is a matter of blood flow, so exercise is exceedingly helpful for keeping these tissues healthy. A lot of the nerve symptoms that come from spinal problems are related to blood flow. So let's just say if you're an athlete and you've got excellent blood flow, that translates to good blood flow to your nerves and all of your tissues. And if you end up needing surgery anyways, everything will heal far better if you are in better shape and your core is stronger and your blood flow is better.
To schedule an appointment with a physician specializing in back pain, call the Henry Ford McComb Physicians Referral Service at 1-800-532-2411. For Shelby This Week, this has been John Martin reporting.
Good information on back problems. There was a big turnout at the library for the summer reading program with a combination of science illusions with magic. It was the Science and Magic event. Magician Jeff Warzizek came out and wowed the big audience.
I found out that if I just let her fall and give a little squeeze and you just blow on it. See it comes apart? There's two of them, okay? Now, Haley, this one is George and this one is Irving. Which one do you like the best, George or Irving?
George.
She likes George. I'll pop a George right over there. I'm going to hold on to Irving. We're going to let Haley hold on to George. So, Haley, hold out your hand. Squeeze really tight. Don't let me go good because a strange thing happens if I wave this over my hand and then over your hand. Did you feel that? See, she's feeling pretty good today. See, mine just disappeared. How about yours, Haley? Is it still there? Open your hand. Open up. Oh, she's got both of them. Pretty cool.
There was storytelling, a lot of laughs, a lot of excitement, and of course, magic. Kids walked away with a unique magic trick of their own, a unique event for all to enjoy. Up next, an exciting senior game. Stay tuned. A big game happened at Mace Decker Park recently. It was the finals for the Seniors Softball League. 14 people on a team, two teams playing their hearts out for the championships that will be held in Utah. The Pet Supplies Plus Bulldogs played against the Downriver Merchants. Unfortunately, our local team, the Pet Supplies Plus Bulldogs, lost 17-15. Great work, boys, on all your hard work. And that's Shelby this week. You can watch us online all the time at ShelbyTV.org. And remember to like us on Facebook at facebook.com/ShelbyTWPTV. Thanks for watching.